progressive, open-minded people like you and me.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Welcome home, LA. We're all in this together.
Let's get it on.
It's KBLA Talk 1580, broadcasting from the heart of LA's Leimert Park. We've got a lot to talk about.
We are going to have to fight. We're going to have to struggle. We're going to have to struggle relentlessly to bring about the peace.
Hi, this is Tavis.
Tavis, this is Dr. Kane. We've got a lot to talk about. I'll be in town on the 28th of February. Can you clear your calendar?
Absolutely, Dr. King. Good Lord, do I have some questions for you, sir. Hi, it's Tavis.
Assalamu alaikum, my brother. This is Minister Malcolm. Now, I heard that you and Martin are getting together for a public dialogue on February 28th. You see, now, I already know the date. Now, I know y'all not trying to keep me out of that conversation, are you?
No, sir. No, sir.
What happened to George Floyd shouldn't happen, not even to a dog. How long must the Negro continue to endure this foolishness at the hands of law enforcement? People can take but so much before they reach a breaking point.
What do you mean, Black Lives Matter? Black lives haven't mattered in this country since Negroes stopped working for free at the end of slavery. You ought to be talking about Black Guns Matter and start your own NRA. Call it the Negro Revolutionary Amalgamation.
Don't miss this compelling historic radio event, The Return. When Tavis Smiley converses with Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr. Tuesday, February 28th, 9 a.m. Pacific Time, exclusively on KBLA Talk 1580.
Samara Joy, that's Black Girl Magic right there. So strong. She's like 23. It's insane. Anyway, I'm really excited to welcome in another music aficionado who also happens to be the representative of the 8th District, where this radio station sits in Los Angeles. He chairs the Planning and Land Use Committee, a lifelong champion of equity and community building. I've witnessed that with my own eyes. City Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson.
Good morning, Dominique, and good morning to the KBLA family. It's good to be here, bright and early on a Tuesday morning.
Yeah, it's great to have you in, and I just realized I haven't seen you since we elected Mayor Karen Bass.
Yes. So. I think I was pushing hard during the election, and I think I've done a couple of phones, but I haven't been to the station, so it's very, very good to be here.
It's great to have you in. This must be, I mean, I was thinking about it before the interview today. This must be very surreal for you. I know because I sat on the board of the Community Coalition that you started with her as a youth organizer.
That's right. Started with Karen as a youth organizer at Community Coalition, and she had a vision for what the organization could do. and the role the organization could play in the city and in the country. And, you know, needless to say, she's exceeded that and much more. Every time I look at that board of the list of, you know, mayor, city attorney, and all the council members, I just chuckle a little bit.
It's wild. You've, of course, followed her into the leadership of Community Coalition when she went to the assembly.
Yep.
I was on the board. I watched you do your thing.
Yes, yes. Followed her into leadership. Did that for about 10 years. One of the great things about Community Coalition, and I this is the shout out to everybody who's working for any kind of nonprofit organization, church, whatever it is that you're trying to build, people need to make time commitments. I was the CEO for 10 years. Karen was the CEO for 15 years. Alberto, who's now the CEO, is going on 7-8 years with no end in sight. You need that kind of consistency in order to build powerful institutions and organizations, which our community needs.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to open that can of worms because we could start talking about politicians and how long they stay in a seat.
Yeah. This is just different. This is a pit stop. This is just, you know, where you got to, you know, play your role a little bit. I think of this like a basketball game. It's like, I got to go in and get rebounds, and then, you know, I go back to what I was doing before. And I think that's the healthiest way to think about elected office, particularly in the context of places like California.
Do you feel added pressure or added opportunity or maybe both? How is that manifesting for you with, you know, you being in the city council and your mentor being the mayor?
Yeah, you can't blow it. You can't say both of us were in the building and we didn't get enough done. So you do feel a lot of pressure. Like it, you know, before, you know, I was on the sort of left edge margin of the council.
Right.
And the, you know, it was mostly sort of moderate or liberal Democrats. And so, you know, you have fights that you know you're not going to win. Well, now there's no excuse for that. Like, there is not just Karen Bass in the mayor's office, but, you know, we elected a slate of progressives up and down the ballot, not just in the city hall, but also in the state.
Yeah, we were talking about you with Fernando Guerra when he was on this show, and he said, okay, Marqueece is no longer the progressive, Marqueece Harris-Dawson, Councilmember Harris-Dawson, is no longer the cutting-edge progressive on the council. How do you see that shaping up? Like, some folks say, okay, they're not going to get anything done. They've got all these progressives. They're not going to get anything done. On the other hand, I see it. It seems like it could be a real window of opportunity. I feel like with you guys in the council and Mayor Bass in the leadership, if there was ever a time when we could fix up our city, it's right now.
You know, that's right. I think you're exactly right. You know, just look, a week ago, I've had an encampment for 7 years at the corner of Western and 87, somewhere between 20 and 35 people. You go to that intersection now, it's completely clean. We housed almost 30 people. They're indoors now. We're doing it again this morning. If anybody's gotten off the 110 freeway going south at Century Boulevard, you know that there's been an encampment there. We're going to deal with that one this morning. Venice, Hollywood, Mid-City, the Valley. Look, there's nothing more important for us than getting our folks off the street.
But we're still talking hundreds. I mean, all the ones you mentioned plus the, Safer Inside, we're now, what, 300 approximately?
Yeah, we're 300 deep we're 300 deep with about 6 weeks. But here's the thing about this. You just got to get the momentum going.
Yeah.
Because these things are a cycle. So once I get you into a motel, I get you stabilized. Sometimes you find housing on your own. Sometimes we can connect you with a family member that maybe you didn't have access to when you were struggling with one challenge or another. And then you move out of that motel and we move somebody else in. So that's how we get the churn going. And the city could never do that. I mean, as simple as it sounds to house 300 people, we could never do that before.
I mean, it doesn't sound that simple
because
housing in LA is super expensive and not so easy to come by. But I'm just saying, when you look at 40,000+ people, it seems like a tiny...
Yeah, you just got to get, you know, it's like, again, to use another sports analogy, you know, you're down by 25, you hit 2 threes in a row, and suddenly the energy moves in
suddenly we're back in the game.
Yeah, you're back in the game, and the energy is moving your own direction. And I think we can absolutely defeat it as we continue to create momentum and change lives. I mean, that's the other dynamic is, you know this because you've been around the community, the people best situated to draw people who are on the streets off are people with lived experience.
Yeah.
The more people with lived experience that we get stabilized, get them into jobs, the better we're going to do at pulling people off the street.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think momentum is everything, although respectfully, council member, I think we should be using football analogies, not basketball
analogies.
Okay,
I'll take it. It's Super Bowl week. Yeah, that's Super Bowl week. We have two black quarterbacks in there. What am I doing?
talking with council member Marqueece Harris-Dawson, who is over the 8th District. I'm Dominique DiPrima for KBLA Talk 1580.
The station you turn to when you've had it up to here with cultural incompetence. KBLA Talk 1580.
The first time I tried to quit vaping, I told myself that it was like a mountain that I had to climb over. And once I got to the other side, it would be clear. But I couldn't make it over. What really got me to quit was my little sister. I saw her vaping. So I was back in the mountain, but this time, she was up there with me. It's weird what you can do for others that you won't do for yourself.
Every attempt is part of your story to quit for good. Visit Kick It California today at kickitca.org.
The Millionaires Roundtable with Lynn Richardson is creating millionaires one family, one day, $1, one dime at a time. KBLA Talk 1580 will be celebrating Black History Month wealth with Lynn Richardson live on Wednesday, February 22nd at the Chase Community Center on Crenshaw and Vernon in Leimert Park. Come check out the space. This location has been a bank branch for over 44 years and is now a community center. It provides resources and education to help the community with money goals, home ownership, and entrepreneurship. You and a guest can win lunch with Lynn Richardson February 22nd. Go to KBLA1580.com or the KBLA 1580 mobile app today and register. See you there.
Wireless headphones. That'll be $200.
I'll use my Capital One Quicksilver card.
Now that's a hit. You used the Capital One Quicksilver card, which makes you the hero of every purchase. With Quicksilver, you earn unlimited 1.5% cash back on every purchase everywhere.
I wanted running music, but unlimited 1.5% cash back is pretty heroic.
Good instincts. Every hero needs a theme song. The Capital One Quicksilver card. What's in your wallet?
Terms apply. See CapitalOne.com for details.
Are you working way too hard for way too little? There's never been a better time to consider a career in IT. You could enjoy a recession-resistant career in a rewarding field with plenty of growth opportunities and often flexible work environments. Go to mycomputercareer.edu and take the free career evaluation. You can start your new career in months, not years. Take classes online or on campus, and financial aid is available to qualified students, including the GI Bill. Now's the time. Go to mycomputercareer.edu.
Thanks for waking up with Dominique DiPrima on KBLA Talk 1580.
And Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson is my guest. There's so much going on right now in the 8th District. We are in the middle of a lot of transition, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. It's beautiful to see the metro stations open instead mm-hmm. of the constant construction that was driving me crazy.
Yes.
But we're about to see some more construction, right?
Yes. We're in the finishing stages of Sankofa Park at Destination Crenshaw, which is sort of the crown jewel.
Which is our backyard at KBLA. Which is the backyard. Also known as KBLA's backyard.
Every time I come here, the construction arrangement's a little bit different and the parking's a little bit different. But we hope to complete that this fall. Knock on wood. You know, one of the things I learned working on this project is that in California, we don't do construction when it rains.
Right.
As opposed to the rest of the world. So that's pushed us back sometime. But I think by the fall, we will complete the project.
Yeah, and we don't do a lot of things when it rains.
No, I know.
It's a uniquely California thing.
Right. It's like
not
a
getting
snow
my
day.
Shoes dirty. Yeah. So explain what Sankofa Park really is. I was just joking about it being...
So Sankofa Park will be the largest public art installation for black artists in the country. Some of our greatest artists will have 3D sculptures there. We'll have monument-sized pieces of art in addition to 2D art, so your murals and your paintings and your etchings, your landscaping and your lighting. All of that will be at Sankofa Park. Sankofa Park will also be a gathering place, and it will be a place where you can have events, where artists can come and do impromptu concerts, or we can have spoken word, or whatever. And it will be a companion to Leimert Park, and really serve as a a landmark for the permanence of the black community in Los Angeles.
Yes. Tell everybody say that again. Right. A landmark for the permanence of black people in Los Angeles. We ain't going nowhere.
That's right. As long as this is a city, we're going to be in it.
You know, and it's funny because when I interview you, I always do my best to ask some of the tough questions and be objective because we are friends.
Yeah.
And I've known you for a really long time.
That's right.
Sometimes listeners, our KBLA delegation will DM me and say, ask your friend, Councilmember Harris-Dawson. And so I think I get a lot of feedback, even though I don't work for your office. And, you know, and I think there is a lot of misunderstanding about Destination Crenshaw. Now, technically, Sankofa Park is part of Destination Crenshaw, right?
Yes, yes. Sankofa Park is the crown jewel of Destination Crenshaw. It is the northern end of Destination Crenshaw. It ends in the...
So people think it's part of gentrification, that you're fixing it up for the white people that are rapidly moving in
here.
And
Dominique, that one's just tough for me. And that's, you know, going back to Community Coalition, we go in to do a park cleanup, and they'll be like, oh, you clean up the park for the white people. It's like, well, we can't have a clean park. We can't have monuments. We can't declare our presence here. This neighborhood produces some of the greatest artists in the world.
Yeah.
But you have to leave the neighborhood to see their work. It's ridiculous. So, you know, what we say to folks is let's fix up things and do it in our image. And, I, you know, people will look me in the eye and say, oh, yeah, you're putting up black art to help white people. It's just all very peculiar.
Well, we're not used to cities and counties and states investing in our communities without an ulterior motive.
And, I think that's right. That's and renewal has always been a code for removal.
Right. I mean, I saw in Seattle where the white the black community organized to drive out a Trader Joe's because they didn't feel it was for us.
Exactly.
And I'm like, let the Trader Joe's come, and then we just have to circle our wagons.
Right.
And do things to make sure we can stay.
Right. And you know, Los Angeles, the black community in Los Angeles, particularly here in the Crenshaw District, is in a particular position.
Right.
Most people are not renters. They're owners. There are a lot of renters, for sure. But they're owners.
You mean in Crenshaw?
I mean in the
Crenshaw
overall
district. LA is mostly renters.
Overall,
but
LA
you're saying South LA has a lot
South
of owners.
South LA, and I'm talking black residents in particular, are homeowners.
Yeah.
So
like me.
You get to decide when you sell and
which
when
is
you
why
don't.
I keep telling people not to sell, and then people get mad at me because they say people have a right to sell
of
if
course
they
you have a right
want
to sell.
Cash out, right. But try to sell to somebody black or
but it's different than when you're in an
black.
Apartment and the landlord can just keep raising your rent until you can't afford it.
Right.
That
right.
you don't have any control over at all.
Right.
But when you own, you have a lot of control, and gentrification only works if sellers cooperate with it.
Right. But right now, and I think one of the reasons there's so much controversy around Destination Crenshaw is because it's happening right at the moment where we see this huge uptick in white folks moving in, you know. And I read in the LA Times it was something supposed to be something like 2% or 3% of our community, but I think that's an old statistic.
Yeah.
Because everywhere I go, I see white people walking their dogs, rollerblading in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
And so it feels like... It feels, you know, it makes it seem like Destination Crenshaw is part of that. On the other hand, I know you're a follower of Nipsey Hussle. I also notice black people buying the block, opening businesses, and doing things that we haven't seen in places like D.C. where we were, and San Francisco, where we were gentrified out of existence.
Yep, yep, yep. Look, the big developers on Crenshaw, part of it is that people have stepped up, and I cannot stress enough how much Nipsey Hussle impacted this discussion. Because here you had a guy who was selling socks and T-shirts in front of a mini mall. And, you know, within the space of about 12 or 13 years, bought the mini mall.
Right.
So, like, that's an inspiring story. The top developers on Crenshaw Boulevard at this moment are all black developers. Now, again, they're going to do developments. We got to make sure they get – we do everything we can to attract black residents to occupy the spaces that they create. That's going to happen. You do see people buying house after house after house. That, I feel like, has turned.
And flipping them, you mean, or black people?
No. I mean black people are setting up households where, you know, before it used to be the realtor would take you to Calabasas or somewhere in the valley or the west side to buy a house. Now people are seeking out our neighborhood. And so, again, these processes are slow and hard to see, but I do think it's going to turn around because I do think people are starting to see the value.
What is happening with Nipsey Hussle Square?
You know,
it
Nipsey Hussle,
right
yeah, it does look crazy right now. You know, there's a lot of work that we had to do, a lot of security work. Look, the family's still deciding how they want to proceed. You know, the family and David Gross, you know, have a partnership with each other.
Right.
They're still deciding how they want to proceed. They've had a few ideas. Some of them include acquiring parcels around it to allow them to do something bigger. I think that's one of their one of the things they'd like to see happen. But those things take time.
Right. I mean, I heard they were going to do a museum, but then I heard that the rumor on the street that the conflict with city government, and the police department was kind of keeping it in limbo.
Well, the conflict with the police department and the city departments is not keeping anything in limbo. If they want to do something, we can do it. I mean, I'm the councilman, I'm the chairman of the Plum Committee. So they can do whatever they want to do. They need to decide. It's very difficult. I mean, we think of it as Nipsey Hussle Square, and we celebrate it because it's so...
Right. Everybody wants to go take a picture.
For his family, that's where he died.
Yeah, that's a great
so
point.
So it's makes sense to me. Where he was murdered, where he was taken.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right on that soil. And so, you know, that I think it makes it challenging in ways that it might not otherwise be.
Yeah. Okay, so let's talk. We said we were going to talk traffic enforcement.
Yes, yes.
And part of what's happening right now is the final stages of building Destination Crenshaw, which is not just Sankofa Park, but also improvements up and down Crenshaw from right about where we are right now all the way up to Slauson, right? Mm-hmm. So what's happening with traffic and construction? And
well, you know, look, they've got some bike lanes to do. We've got some pocket parks to build. We've got some landscaping to do. So you'll still see a good amount of activity on Crenshaw Boulevard for probably the remainder of this year. And then I think it'll tail off significantly.
Unless it keeps raining.
Unless it keeps raining, which people say that we need. Which it feels that way until it's actually raining.
Right, exactly.
Too much rain. So that'll happen. And, you know, one of the dynamics that we have in Los Angeles that I'm really concerned about with Crenshaw once it's fully up and running is LA is the most dangerous city for bicyclists and pedestrians. We have more pedestrian and bicycle deaths than anybody else because people drive fast. And so we're trying to build our roads in a way that slow people down. But of course, the more you do that, the more upset people are because it takes, I get upset because it takes longer to get places.
Right.
But, you know, we have, you know, Western Boulevard in my district, Arlington, and Crenshaw before the construction. I mean, the construction has had the effect of stopping a lot of that because, you know, you can't just, you know, do 70 down Crenshaw anymore.
Not
because,
as much.
not as much as
I mean,
used
people
to.
Go hella fast on Crenshaw and Leimert.
Yes.
I'm like, are you kidding me right now? This is not a freeway.
We have these roads where the lanes are built for those big giant Cadillacs and Buicks that they used to have back in the day. We still have the lanes are that size, except our cars are much smaller now. So you have a lot of room to pick up speed and maneuver and correct when you make a mistake in driving. So what happens is people drive faster. And so we got to undo that over time.
So what does that look like?
Well, you got to thin out the lanes. We got to do more bike lanes. We got to do more of that thing where they put the bike lane and then the parking and then the street. Mm-hmm. You know, kind of like you see on Figueroa between Jefferson and Adams. It's a dramatically different driving experience, which I will admit to as a driver I hate. But it's much more safe because over there they would, you know, a lot of students would get hit walking and biking in the
The critique is that we're prioritizing bicycles rather than traffic congestion.
And I will tell you what, I was like that too, because they put a bike lane in front of my house and I was like, don't nobody ride a bike over here, and if they do, they don't need a bike lane for it. But what the bike lane does is it slows down the cars, whether bikes are in it or not, oddly enough, because it makes the lane thinner, right? And so you feel like you're driving down you know, when you drive down a street and there are cars parked on both sides?
Right.
You don't
But why wouldn't you say just add another lane and then we'd have less traffic?
That's one theory. The other thing I say is what we don't have, particularly in my district, is parking. So I would say add another row of parking to allow people to park, you know, is staggered or something like that. That would do it. But I think the point is we got to get around to doing that. We also got to deal with enforcement. So, you know, one of the things that's coming back up now with the loss of Keenan Anderson, who was involved in a traffic accident and called police and ended up dying as a result of calling police, is that we got to have other ways at getting at traffic safety than, you know, waiting for a government worker with a gun to show up and do whatever. You know, LAPD makes as many or more traffic stops than any other police department, and we don't have any pedestrian or bicycle safety to show for it. And unfortunately, on the other hand, we got a lot of police brutality, of police misconduct, and death. to show for it. And so, you know, we want to look at alternative forms of both enforcement and creating safety for everybody on the road, the people in the cars, the people walking, and the people on bicycles.
Yeah, I mean, we've got 2 minutes here before news, traffic, and sports. We'll continue on the other side. But one of the things I heard your deputy chief of staff speaking on was the work you're doing to lead us in the direction of taking cops out of stops.
Yeah. I mean, look, I think at the big, the macro picture, the meta narrative is, if I have a broken taillight or I'm going 5 minutes over the limit or I roll through a stop sign, do I need to be confronted by a person with a deadly weapon?
Right. And I feel like the pushback from the PPL, I mean, from the police
The pushback
association
from the PPL is that we should be doing everything.
Well, and also they kind of targeted you and said he's conflating, you know, traffic stops with high-speed chases and dangerous situations. And I felt like it was just the opposite. I felt like they were the ones conflating
it.
Because you were saying, this is what, well, correct me if I'm wrong, but what I was getting is that, if I have a taillight out or expired tags, I can have a civilian agency possibly do that.
Same way parking enforcement. The parking enforcement comes up to give you a ticket. Parking enforcement can boot and tow your car.
Right.
They don't have a gun.
They don't chase you either.
Yeah, they don't chase you. I mean, and the point is, if you run, then we call the police. If you're, you know, if you're doing 120 down Crenshaw, that's not a traffic violation. That's a public safety hazard.
Yeah.
So somebody else needs to deal with you. But the vast majority of traffic stops aren't public safety risks. They just aren't. I'll give you an example. If I get pulled over for a broken taillight, what happens? They give me a ticket and they say, you know, you got to fix it by this time and come back to court. And then what do? They send me off in the car with the broken taillight.
True that.
Now, if the taillight was truly unsafe, of course they wouldn't put me back on the road with it. There are places in the world, we're studying them, where if you get pulled over for a fix-it ticket, you know what happens? The person fixes it.
There's an idea.
If you have a broken taillight, they fix your taillight, and your ticket is you get a bill in the mail for the cost of fixing your light.
Talking with Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson, I want to talk a little bit about that process and what else is going on in the 8th District and in City Council when we come forward.
Yes.
KBLA Talk 1580.
More of First Things First with Dominique DiPrima when we come forward.
I'm Mike Moore. Here's the latest from the Black Information Network. Two U.S. search and rescue units are on their way to Turkey to assist in the aftermath of Monday's earthquake. Each unit will include 70 personnel with search dogs, that according to U.S. Ambassador to Turkey, Jeff Flake. Flake says any Americans who want to help should direct donations through the Red Cross, nonprofits, and church groups. Today is National Black HIV AIDS Awareness Day. The CDC says while blacks and African Americans make up 13% of the U.S. population, they account for 40% of those with HIV.
We estimate 250,000 people know they have HIV in this country and are not seeking regular medical care.
Dr. Laura Shever there, she's an AIDS expert at the Health Resources and Service Administration. And that's the latest. I'm Mike Moore from your 24/7 news source, the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
Got a crash in West LA, 405 southbound on the Sunset Boulevard off-ramp. I don't think any lanes are blocked on the ramp, but it is stop and go from Devonshire Street. In mid-city, LA CHP working a crash on the 10 westbound for Robertson Boulevard. That's on the right-hand shoulder where you're seeing heavy delays at Hoover Street. And you got a truck stalled in Baldwin Park. Carpool lane blocked on the 10 westbound for Francisquito Avenue. Watch for sudden slowing in the carpool and left-hand lanes. In Anaheim, watch for vehicle stall block in the mid lane, 5 northbound at Catella Avenue. We are seeing traffic backing up behind that.
Jackson Hewitt gets you your biggest tax refund guaranteed, plus a chance to double your refund or win weekly prizes with our Double Your Refund sweepstakes. File your taxes on the double. No purchase necessary. U.S. residents 18 or older who file a 2022 federal tax return. Ends 4/2/22.
This is the KBLA Sports Minute with Ray Richardson.
On October 30th, 2003, a rookie named LeBron James scored his first regular season points in the NBA. He was 18 that night. 20 years later, LeBron is on the doorstep of scoring more points than any player in NBA history. In tonight's home game against Oklahoma City, LeBron needs only 36 points to pass Kareem Abdul-Jabbar as the NBA's all-time scoring leader. Kareem has the record with 38,387 points. The Clippers beat Brooklyn last night by 8, 29 points for Paul George, Kawhi Leonard added 24, No debates, no speculation, just the info you need. That's your KBLA Sports Minute. I'm Ray Richardson. This sports report was brought to you by Original Taco Pizza.
This is Aaron at Original Taco Pizza. Let us cater your Super Bowl party and future events. Call 323-348-4441 and visit us at 3272 West Slauson off Crenshaw.
Your milkshake? Quick, the quicker picker upper. Bounty picks up spills quicker. And each sheet is 2 times more absorbent, so you can use less than the leading ordinary brand. So you can get back to your milkshake.
My milkshake brings all the boys to the yard, and they're like, it's better than your
Bounty, the quicker picker upper.
Let's get back to business, Los Angeles County. The Economic Opportunity Grant Program is now open. This program is designed to provide financial support to qualified small businesses, micro entrepreneurs, food industry businesses such as restaurants, and nonprofits in Los Angeles County. Approximately 4,600 grants of up to $2,500 each will be administered to qualified micro businesses that face barriers to accessing capital resources. To learn more about the Economic Opportunity Grant Program, visit www.grants.lacounty.gov. The application process is fast and easy. Don't miss the opportunity to get back to business. This program is administered by the County of Los Angeles through its Department of Economic Opportunity and funded in part through a grant from the California Office of the Small Business Advocate. The application portal is powered by Lendustry. Visit www.grants.lacounty.gov and get back to business.
Hi, I'm Areva Martin, and I'm the host of the new Drive Time show, Areva Martin in Real Time, on KBLA Talk 1580. I'm also a mother and a child advocate, and when my son Marty was diagnosed with autism, I was devastated. I knew I had to do something, so I started the Special Needs Network, and for over 15 years, we have been helping families with children with autism. Now, through a new program called CORE, we can help you. We can help you take your career to the next level by training you to become an early childhood interventionist, working with children ages 0 to 3. The CORE program will pay you $25 an hour while you are in training, pay off $10,000 of your student loan debt, and help you find a good paying job. Call 323-291-7100 or visit snnla.org to learn how you can become a CORE fellow and take your career to the next level. Don't hesitate. Apply today.
We know you stick around. This is LA's home for progressive talk radio. Welcome back to KBLA Talk 1580.
Talking with 8th District Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson. And there's so much to cover. Luckily, I'm pretty sure you'll grace us with your presence again.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because, you know, we're not going to be able to get through redistricting and all of these crossroads issues for our city right now.
Yep.
But it's great news that Sankofa Park is meant to open in the fall, and I guess Destination Crenshaw will follow not too far after that.
Yep, 2024 will be a big year for us. It'll be a big year for the Crenshaw District. It'll be a big year for our community. And it's, you know, for us, it's a symbolic planting of the flag in the ground. It's the physical manifestation of the spirit of our people who said, you know, we're going to lock in, load up, and live out our lives here.
Let's go to Morris, calling us from Inglewood. Hi, Morris. Thank you for your patience.
Are they still getting down where we used to go and dance? Will our ball club win the pennant? Do you think they have a chance? And tell me frankly, how in the world have you been? You know something? America's going to have a tough time living down black slavery, and the Grammys are going to have a tough time snubbing Marvin Gaye for What's Going On album. That album is as old as I am, and it's still very relevant to today. Nothing has really changed. It's just kind of taken a different form. But I love me some Marvin Gaye, and the Grammys are just as political as everything else. Good morning to you, Dominique, and good morning to your guests, too, by the way.
Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, we spent a lot of time this morning talking about the Grammys because a lot of us are mad.
Bad Bunny, Kendrick Lamar, Beyonce,
yes,
or Mary J., not Harry Styles.
Yeah, I know you're a council member, but you're also a music aficionado.
Yeah, yeah.
See you on your podcast with all them albums in the background and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it was, that was rough. I had never, Beyoncé's been drawn wrong three times. This was the most wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, Bruno Mars is kind, you know, that was, I kind of get that a little bit, I guess. And Adele is Adele. But, you know, even Adele got up and walked out when they announced Harry Styles, which I don't blame her.
Yeah, I think the Grammys have radicalized Adele.
Right. No, totally. she rolled her eyes and, like, got up and kept it moving.
Yeah.
I don't understand how they come up with these formulations.
Well, yeah, I mean, we keep participating. I guess it's the big show.
Well, not only do we participate, it rides on us. Like, right. If we walk away from it, it doesn't happen. Yeah. It just doesn't.
Right. I don't see us walking away, but maybe, mm-hmm. maybe. Stranger mm-hmm. things have happened.
But we got to, you know, at some point we got to figure that out.
So, I mean, and speaking of figuring stuff out, right, we talked a little bit about gentrification. Mm-hmm. And I keep saying, like, what are the things that we can do, well, really that you can do, the city council, the mayor, and us, the voters, to put programs in place that help Black businesses stay here, that help Black homeowners, especially our seniors, stay here. And I know you've been, you know, you were out front on the changes that have been made to renter protections. Mm-hmm. But I'm also talking about, you know, helping Black businesses buy if they don't own, helping Black homeowners who are struggling to stay. Not just the unhoused, but the ones that are in danger of.
Well, I do think there are a couple of things. I think we need homeowner programs, particularly for seniors, particularly for people who are trying to pass property from one generation to another. It's in the handoff between generations where we suffer a lot of loss. You know, the probate stuff is, you know, I think something like, I think in my district, I think the probate stuff is like 1 or 2 out of 10 probate transfers goes to an African-American person.
Wow.
In this community, which is still, after all the talk and all of it, the latest last year's survey, we're still 69% here in the Crenshaw District African-American, which is, I keep waiting for it to plummet based on what I see out there.
Yeah.
But the handoff is where we get the most challenge. And I think we can, the city and the county and other, the government can do a lot there. Just like we have rental assistance, we can have homeowners assistance.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the second thing with businesses, here's the biggest thing I think the city can do, is do business with our businesses.
Well, yeah.
So that's why, I'm very proud of this to this day. During the pandemic, you know, we got to help people. It's an emergency. We got to get food to seniors because they can't leave the house. And we stepped up and we said, give that money to our restaurants to make food and take it to the seniors in our neighborhood. Not one restaurant that participated in that program closed.
Yeah.
We're all still open.
I actually went on a ride-along with Carrie from Earl's.
Oh, very nice.
And,
okay.
Yeah, and watched the meals being delivered and how grateful the seniors were for the meals. But also the contact, right?
That's right.
A person from the community coming to your house.
That person gets to see about you, and they can mm-hmm. say, hey, like, I've been here 3 days, and this person doesn't come to the door. Somebody should check. There's that. There's someone seeing about you. There's also awareness of the restaurant. So a lot of seniors say, oh, I never knew this restaurant was here. I'll use it once the pandemic is over.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they've been going to the same place for the last, you know, 40 years
yeah.
or whatever it is. So it was good for marketing. It was just good for cash flow because most businesses, you know, South LA Cafe will tell you they had already drawn up the letters terminating their employees when they got a call from the city saying, we want you to help us with meals. And they kept everybody on. They've expanded. Now they're at the Natural History Museum, at Kaiser. I mean, they got 5 locations now. So I think that's the biggest thing we can do. And I'm really excited about Kenneth Mejia, the new controller, who a lot of people are afraid of. I'm frankly excited about him.
He's a CPA. How scary can he be?
Right. He's a CPA. He's a nice enough guy. But one thing I'm going to say to him is one of the reasons why community businesses can't do business with the city is our bureaucracy is too crazy.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
the city takes 60, 90, 120 days to pay you.
Yeah.
And we don't have that kind of float in our community. Yeah. So most people say no. I'm going to say to him, like, you want to transform things in the community? Change this process so that our people can do work, get paid in a simple way, working on behalf of their neighbors.
Yeah, I think it's a great point. I've heard a lot of businesses say that. I can't mm-hmm. loan the city, you know, inventory right. for 90 days.
Exactly.
So, yeah, back circling back to the cops and cops out of stops thing.
Yeah.
I know there's a study that we're waiting for.
Yeah, so there's a study that we're waiting for. We're doing a scan of the world to see what programs exist. We know there are programs in Portland and Eugene, Oregon. There's a program in Seattle. We have a pilot program here in Los Angeles that we're now in the process of auditing. But here's what we know. For mental health calls, if you send a mental health provider, that tends to work better. Police almost never have to be called. I think it's something less than 5% of the time does the mental health worker get to the location and go, oh, I actually need a police officer. In all the cases that we've seen, both here and outside of the state. Also, again, we're getting a raw deal on traffic. Our streets are not safe for pedestrians and bicyclists and, frankly, other people in cars. And we have all this harassment. I mean, it. You know, there's a story, an anecdote I tell about a manager of a store, a chain store in my district, who lives in Fontana. So he has to drive in every day. So he says, you know, in any given year, I get stopped 5 or 6 times getting off the freeway when I get into LA. He's like, meanwhile, my store can get robbed and the police will take 6 hours to get there. So an actual crime, you get a 6-hour response. Mm-hmm. A no crime, you're just black in a car, you get stopped multiple times per year. The same person in the same vehicle coming from the same place.
The same business owner.
The same business.
Right.
In exactly the same location. Like, it's not like he gets off at different exits. He gets off at the same exit every day. So I think we can really transform the relationship between the police and the community by taking away this sort of hunting aspect. Because that's how it feels when you get stopped. It feels like you're being hunted.
It's scary. Yeah. I mean, doesn't surprise me. People run. I wish they wouldn't. Mm-hmm. But so, in other words, we'd have to have the study out and get some recommendations.
Yeah.
And then I understand there's a state law that has to be changed.
There are some state laws that have to be changed. So, for example, state law says that only a sworn officer can operate a radar gun. Obviously, you know, anybody who's been on Slauson between Crenshaw and La Brea knows that we need people with radars there because, you know, that's a raceway otherwise. But does that person have to be a person with a gun? That we can't change locally. We have to change at the state.
So the whatever the state regulations are that keep civilians from operating those traffic stops. Interesting. Yeah, when we come forward, I do want to talk a little bit about what's going on in the city council, the dynamics
please.
There.
Yes.
You guys still have a disgraced racist Councilmember Kevin De Leon have been able to move forward with the business of the city. So we'll talk about that when we come forward. KBLA Talk 1580.
She's reclaiming her time on KBLA Talk 1580. More First Things First with Dominique DiPrima when we come forward.
The California Reparations Task Force agrees to extend its work to 2024. Maisha Cairo here with your K-Black Minute News, brought to you by CaliforniaBlackMedia.org. The California Task Force to Study and Develop Reparation Proposals for African Americans in California decided at the 2-day meeting on campus of San Diego State that it would support legislation that extends the panel until July of next year. An 8-0 vote with one abstention is what moved the date that was previously set for the summer of this year. The goal now is to have ample time to satisfactorily implement an action plan based on the findings of its final report, which is due in 5 months. This decision was made 4 months after Governor Gavin Newsom vetoed legislation asking for a 12-month extension. I'm Aisha Cairo, and that's your K-Black Minute News.
Here at McKay's Family Mortuary, we offer a full line of services with a fine selection of caskets and urns. Also, assistance with cemeteries along with luxury limousine and funeral coaches and other needs pertaining to your family's wishes for your loved one. We accept Veterans Victim Witness Program for mortuary services only at zero cost to you. Cemetery selection does not apply. All insurances are accepted. McKay's Funeral Home understands that saying goodbye is never easy. That's why we've been providing compassionate and professional funeral services to the community for over a decade. Please contact McKay's Family Mortuary, serving Los Angeles, San Bernardino, and Riverside counties and the High Desert. 3918 Marine Avenue, Lawndale, California. 310-978-8877. That's 310-978-8877. By appointment only or log on to McKaysMortuaries.com.
Hi, I'm Dominique DiPrima. You may think it's too early, but tax season is now. Whether you're filing individual or business taxes, there are benefits to filing your taxes. You can qualify for loans and grants, improve your credit profile, and get into compliance with the IRS. Who files early gets refunded early. And there are lots of legit ways to boost your tax refund in 2023. The tax professionals at Wealth Management Financial Advisors will find every credit and deduction you deserve so you get your largest possible refund. I'm not kidding. You could double your refund just by filing at Wealth Management Financial Advisors. Big chain tax filing companies use a one-size-fits-all formula that leaves money on the table. Don't wait until recession or procrastination. Take a bite out of your budget. Book an appointment now at wealthmanagementlb.com or by calling 562-427-8877. That's 562-427-8877. Visit wealthmanagementlb.com.
Less BS per broadcast. Fewer microaggressions per megawatt. KBLA Talk 1580.
And I want to thank you, 8th District Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson, for coming in live and in person.
It's good to be here.
On YouTube and all that. Where would you say we are? If you were to say state of the city council, we've had the controversy, the crisis around racist, sexist, homophobic, anti-renter, anti-indigenous tape. Excuse me, now a new city council elected slate, a new mayor, but still De Leon refuses to step down despite the polling.
Yeah, look, you know, I think the patient is stabilizing and we still got this open wound that needs to be dealt with, but I think all the other parts are coming together. Look, we got 6 women on the city council for the first time in the history of the city. Got an Asian American in citywide office in the controller's office. We've got a woman in the city attorney's office, first time, woman in the mayor's office, first time. I am excited about what's possible. And, you know, every day that passes, the more boring Kevin De Leon gets.
What do you mean by that?
I just mean it's, you know, he's decided that he's going to be recalcitrant, that he as an individual is more important than the city. He's not going to resign. And so that's going to get dealt with one way or another.
Right, and I like the fact that people aren't forgetting about it.
Yes,
but we're still getting the business done. People
right.
are still protesting, and we still expect this dude to step down or
get recalled. We do,
but we're still moving forward.
Yeah, we move forward with the business of the city again. You can't let a wound on my hand say, oh, I can't go to work. I can't get the work done. It's like you got to do the work and both care for this, care for the ailment that you have. And so, I pray every day that, somebody will speak to Kevin that he can hear and he'll understand how important it is for the city. And I think ultimately for him to resign.
Yeah. Well, hopefully so. It would be nice to avoid those millions of dollars wasted on the recall election. But we got to do what we got to do.
There you go.
Talk to me about what opportunities you see. You know, I think that having the first woman mayor and all the others that you've outlined is important and could create opportunity. I also feel like there's peril. I feel like we're quick to throw an African-American woman under the bus, whether it's the Grammys or the mayor's office. We're quick to give her the hardest jobs and take her to task.
Give her the hardest jobs and the least credit.
Right.
I saw that start from day one with the mayor. So the mayor beat Rick Caruso on $110 million. And the LA Times came out and gave credit to a bunch of white male consultants and pollsters. It's exactly that kind of phenomenon. And just said, hey, wait a minute. Maybe this is such a superior candidate that she was able to do what almost no one else could have done. I don't care what consultants they had. Almost no one else in this region could have done, which was stare down $110 million and beat them. And it wasn't close. Like there was a comfortable margin. So I think it's right that, people talk about black girl magic in general, but they don't talk about it in particular. And I think that gets tough. And I do think there are a bunch of people waiting for something to go wrong, as it will. Or the
$110
city to,
million dollars worth of people.
Right. Or the city to face a challenge, which we will. And suddenly, they're going to say she's not up to the task. And so I think that comes with the territory. But I think that's also what makes it right for this moment, because you're talking about people who've been there. They've been there, done that, seen it.
Yeah. I mean, the LA Times endorsed her.
Yes.
But I do see that kind of a little bit of a double standard, not just with them, with mm-hmm. the, even sure. with our own community.
Right.
You know, a lot of people were angry about the reappointment of Chief Michael Moore. I was myself disappointed, didn't agree with that. But to say, you know, she's failed her first test in leadership, or this is a one-term mayor, to me that's just dumb and it's not strategic.
It's dumb and it's not strategic, and it's what fight are you picking for, to what end?
Right.
And that's the thing. I mean, the man came out and said, I'm only going to serve a couple more years because there needs to be a new chief. She said she only wanted him temporary because she wanted to focus on homelessness. And having been in the city 7 years, Mayor Bass is dead on. The minute she takes her eye off the ball with homelessness, we will revert back to business as usual, which business as usual in this city for homelessness has been, you can't sit on this corner, you can't be at Leimert Park, you can't be in front of this business, but we've got no place for you to go. She's completely transformed that and says, we're coming to give you a place to go, and we're cleaning up this corner, and it's going to stay clean.
Yeah, I think that's right. I also think it's fair to say, you know, we have to be able to multitask.
You do, but homelessness is such a monumental, I think, civilization level problem that your people don't live indoors. I do not think it is among the kinds of things that you multitask. I think it's absolutely right to prioritize it. I mean, you know, we've gone 10 years with over 50,000 people living on the streets.
That's insane.
I mean, it's
and people
ridiculous.
Dying every day.
Right. 5-6 people don't wake up every morning because this or because that. You know, the horror, you know, you go to these encampments and you encounter a woman, and this always happens, 3-4 pair of pants. Because they can't sleep. They can't sleep.
Talking with Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson, when we come forward, I'm going to pass the mic to you and mm-hmm. let you share with us the things you came here to say that we didn't get to, and make sure folks know how to reach you.
Yeah.
This is KBLA Talk 1580.
We may be LA's newest talk station, but when you're punching above your weight, it's not about whether you can throw a punch. Can you take a punch? We're unapologetically progressive, KBLA Talk 1580.
K-O.
And we don't black down.
Are you a business owner, freelancer, or filing taxes for the first time? Are you tired of dodging the IRS? Stop what you're doing now. Mac Tax Solutions, the father and son dynamic duo tax team, is the most sought-out tax business around. Mac Tax Solutions guarantees 100% maximum refund and free consultation. Call now, 562-715-9945. That's 562-715-9945. Or visit MacTaxSolutions.com. IRS or California FTB notices. Free e-file remote tax services with free secure tax dome portal. A $40 gift card will be included when you file. Call now, 562-715-9945. 562-715-9945. Staying on track with all required documents will help you reach your personal and financial goals. Prevent paycheck garnishments. Mac Tax Solutions will even provide all tax programs that your business could be eligible for. Now is the time to make your business work for you. Call now, 562-715-9945. Be sure to download the KBLA app. Tell all your friends and families it's time for a fresh tax start. Call now, 562-715-9945, or visit the website at MacTaxSolutions.com. Call now, 562-715-9945.
Here's how we long for Skechers hands-free slip-in footwear.
The world has gone hands-free. However, if you want to put on a pair of sneakers, you still need to bend down and help your feet in. Until now. Introducing Skechers hands-free slip-in footwear. You don't need to reach down to help your heel in. You just step into them and off you go. So what's the secret? Well, there's a special smooth comfort pillow in the heel that helps your foot slide into place. And they stay on just like a pair of laced-up sneakers.
Get hands-free slip-ins at a Skechers store, Skechers.com, or wherever stylish footwear is sold.
The conversation continues right now with Dominique DiPrima on First Things First.
Okay, we have a few minutes left before we pass the microphone off to Tavis Smiley. Councilmember Marqueece Harris-Dawson, what do you want to make sure you let us, your constituents, know?
Look, I want to make sure everybody is tuned in on the alternatives to traffic enforcement. I think that's the most significant thing policy-wise in front of us. You know, the study is out now. It'll come back soon. We need people to respond and tell their stories. I mean, I think if the larger community knew what people go through and what it means to get stopped by a police officer at night or when you're by yourself or when you're in a neighborhood you don't know, I think we would end this practice right away, out of hand. And so I think we have an opportunity to do that. Unfortunately, it's involved the loss of life because we've seen all these horrific stories and their videos of those horrific stories. But we can do better, and I think it's a big opportunity to do that. And if L.A. does that, if L.A., the car capital of the world, we can move away from traffic stops, we'll change the country.
Yeah, I mean, going back to Sandra Bland now, mm-hmm. Kenan Anderson, yep. You know, and Tyree, you know, Nichols, it does seem stark. I know Berkeley's made the move,
yep.
And so it can't be impossible.
No, it's definitely not impossible. There are other places in the world that don't do this at all. They actually have traffic enforcement. So the people who do traffic enforcing are enforcing traffic. And again, if you're going to act a fool, you're going to victimize somebody, you're going to do something, there will be police to deal with you.
Well,
so
course.
Don't make the mistake of thinking like, oh, you know, this means I can do whatever I want. It doesn't. It just means in this sort of regular course of life, we take the deadly weapon out of the equation.
Right, and when we say the LAPD itself says they're getting away from fishing expeditions, mm-hmm. this is a great way to end those fishing
right,
expeditions.
Right. Just stop.
Yeah.
And if you think someone is a criminal and you want to ask them a question, then you stop them and you say, I think you're a criminal, I'm going to ask
right,
you some questions.
Right, I have probable cause.
Right, yeah, I have probable cause.
It's not your fuzzy dice.
Right.
It's not your taillight.
It's not your air freshener, right.
It's not your hydraulics.
Or anything else, right? And again, even if a police officer says to me, you drive this kind of car and a black male has been caught on camera doing these crimes, I need to check you out. That's an entirely different thing.
Right.
Then are you on parole or probation? Blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, it's 20 minutes before they get to, well, you rolled through the stop sign.
Right.
Like, it's just
folks sitting on the curb. And
yeah.
Yeah.
You just need to be done with it.
Well, I thank you for your work on that. And I'll be tracking it. We'll be loud.
Thank you.
Marqueece Harris-Dawson, thank you so much for coming in. Appreciate
it. Thank you. It's
you.
Good to be here.
MHD.
MHDCD8.
Yeah. MHDCD8.
Instagram, Snap, all of it.
Twitter. Yeah.
All of the what. Yeah.
Tavis Smiley is up next. Until tomorrow, one love.
KBLA 1580 Santa Monica.
I'm Mike Moore. Here's the latest from the Black Information Network.